back then was worth a whole year's wage. Just to give you an idea. And spikenard was a fragrant herb prepared from the roots and the stems of an aromatic herb plant from northern India. It was an expensive perfume imported in, sealed in an alabaster box, which was only open on special occasions. You see, perfume back then was the most precious thing to Eastern women. So Mary was taking her most precious possession and giving it to her Lord. It was sacrificial and costly. Costly because it was worth a whole year's wage. And that's a whole lot of food that could be put on the table. Sacrificial because she was giving up something that was very costly and valuable to her family. And she was giving it up for the sake of another. You see, we will give something up for our family sometimes. But for someone else, that's a different ball game. Mary was giving it up for the sake of another. Now, what do you have that is very costly, valuable, and precious to you? And are you willing to give it up for the sake of another? But not just to another, but to Jesus. Mary comes to Jesus here, going against the grain, because in the midst of many men that were there, because women back then were supposed to be in the background. It wasn't supposed to be up front, but the men were. But Mary comes third, expressing a believing love. She honored Jesus as the Christ, the anointed one of God, the true Messiah. After all, the Bible says in Hebrews 11:6, but without faith, it is impossible to please him. For he that cometh to God must believe that he is, and that he is a rewarder of him that diligently seek him. Believe you, Lord. Mary's anointing was an act of love and faith in Jesus to show how deeply she loved him and believed him to be the true Messiah. She had that believing love, so much so that she set aside pride and embarrassment in order to show her love and faith in Jesus. You see, Mary gave openly here. Now, true love is selfless and costly. True love forgets self and pays whatever price is necessary to show one's love. True love gives his most precious possession. True love is surrendering all that one is and has. Now, how far are you willing to go to show your love and faith to Jesus? Jesus says in Matthew 10:33, but whosoever shall deny me before men, him will I also deny before my Father which is in heaven. But Mary comes here openly in front of all that was there. You see, sometimes, church, you've got to forget who's around you and worship Jesus anyway. Mary comes and anoints the feet of Jesus, John says. But Matthew and Mark say Jesus' head, which was a common custom at festive Jewish meals, anointing the guest's head. This took place from welcoming guests into one home back then, Luke 7:46, or when burying the dead, anointing the head, Mark 14:8. Evidently, she does both.
All right.
She anoints Jesus' head and feet. So there would be no time for anointing Jesus' body later. Because they had labeled Jesus as a criminal. But we know he wasn't a criminal. But also only in the case of a criminal burial once the body is not anointed before laying to rest. So this is why Mary was anointing Jesus for his burial. But John looked at how she anointed Jesus' feet here. Because back in those days, in the hot, dusty country of Palestine, most people wore sandals and their feet became extremely dirty or sometimes muddy. So what I'm trying to say is, Jesus had some dirty feet. But Mary found anyway and anointed them. So when you look at your life, no matter how dirty you are, no matter how many times you mess up, come short of the glory of God, no matter how so off from the flow up you think you are, you still come to Jesus. Jesus says, come unto me, all ye that labor and are heavy laden, and I will give you rest. Come with a repentant love. Come with a sacrificial and a costly love. Come with a believing love to Jesus. Mary comes and anoints his feet. She is worshiping Jesus. She comes as humble as she possibly can. And the Bible says in James 4, saying, humble yourself in the sight of the Lord and shall lift you up. And not only does she worship Jesus by anointing his feet, but she also worships Jesus by using her hair to wipe his feet. Once more, Mary goes against the grain here. But sometimes, you got to go against that grain. She comes to wipe his feet by using her head to wipe his feet. Because women back then was not allowed to let their hair down in public. You see, sometimes, church, you got to move from religion to relationship. It's a personal thing. It's you and Jesus. You got to save yourself. Grandma, grandpa, mama, daddy, aunties and uncles, they can't save you. You got to save yourself. You got to worship him for yourself. Mary comes to worship him. She does not come to be the center of attention like some folks. She does not come to try to gain something for herself like some folks. She does not come to say, look what I did, or look what I did, because I got it going on like some folks. She comes with a repentant love. She comes with a sacrificial and a costly love. She comes with a believing love. She comes to worship Jesus and the Christ to show how deeply she loves him and believes him to be the true Messiah. She came to worship. What about you? What have you come for this morning? The text goes on and says that the house was filled with the odor of the hundred. Which is a true statement. If you open it up, the first filling, and pour it out, the odor is there. Now, the same is true for you. If you truly open up and worship this house, your house, your body, your temple, will be filled with the presence of the Lord. Mary came to worship. Mary came to worship, I say. But B-U-T, better understand this. That when you come to worship, and while you are worshiping, I hate to tell you this, and I don't want to tell you, but I have to tell you, there are some haters out there. Some Jews that's in the midst of your worship that don't want to see you worship the Lord, your Lord and Savior. And we see one right here in the text. One who's working for Jesus and walking with Jesus. The hater. He or she is not worrying about you worshiping and getting close to Jesus. but they have an ulterior motive. Look at what Judas said in verse 5. Why was not this person first sold for 300 pence when it was a whole year's wage and given it to the poor? See, Judas had an ulterior motive. Second, he was the treasurer. And third, the Bible says he was a thief. Judas, the hypocritical, unbelieving disciple, was double dealing, dishonest, two-faced, and self-serving. He wasn't worried about Mary worshiping Jesus. His mind was set on something else. John says in verse 6, this he said, talking about Judas here, not that he cared for the poor, the ulterior motive, but because he was a thief, double-dealing, dishonest, two-faced, self-serving, and had to bag because he was a treasure, and bag what was put therein. He had 50 pennies. That would be exactly. You see, Judas' mind was not set on Mary's worship, but it was set on the bottle of perfume and the money he could have gotten and the money he could have stolen and put in his pocket. The Bible says in 1 Timothy 6:10, for the love of money is the root of all evil. With some, something happened. They have erred from the faith and pierced themselves through with many sorrows. Now, by Judas saying what he said in verse 5, he was beginning to mislead some of the disciples. But some of the disciples focused on Mary's worship. But when Judas said what he said, they started to focus their minds on how Mary was pouring this valuable, very costly perfume on the feet of Jesus and wasting it. They said, so they could have gotten some money and given it to the poor. But better understand this, church, that worshiping Jesus is not wasted.